baseball. The first pitch of the first inning of the second doubleheader to Lutz for the Tigers. Orioles in the field and Tigers up to bat. Second pitch is called for a strike to even the count at one. Abby Malko, joining me today is Todd Beeler.
Hi, Abby.
Thanks for being here. It helps out having a helping hand.
We'll see what we can do. Kane Lutz at the plate. Kane, give you a little insight on some of these kids.
Yes,
here.
Yes, please.
Kane, very good young player, middle infielder, just finished fifth grade this year, and there's a line shot right back up the middle, so a good start for the Tigers.
Nice hit.
Kane will be going into junior high next year, and like I said, he's a nice little pitcher and a middle infielder.
Had a pretty good game last game as well as your leadoff batter. Helped you guys score your first five runs in your first inning.
Yeah, he's a nice, solid little player, and the guy coming to the plate I'm a little bit familiar with, too.
That might be your son, Brock Beeler, the second batter for the Tigers.
Yeah, I'll probably just give him the kiss of death here, but Brock's another nice little player, just finished fifth grade, pitcher, catcher, corner infielder, little outfield.
Is there anywhere he doesn't play?
There's a ball hit to second base and bobble, but a nice recovery.
Nice backhand by the second baseman.
And I think if that looks correct, that is Maverick Cox that made a nice little play there to hang with it.
Yep. But advance the runner to second base, so you have one out with runner in scoring position, bringing Dunwoody up to the plate.
Andrew's caught a lot this year for the Tigers. He steadily improved at that position. He can also play middle infield.
Kane Lutz at second base, Andrew Dunwoody at the plate. One out for the Tigers. Counts 2-0 to Dunwoody.
That's Avery Gates on the mound for the Orioles.
He had a really good game last game. I think he had three doubles for the Orioles.
Another solid player. This Orioles team has a lot of very good young talent, a good mix of kids that just finished fifth grade as well as some kids that just finished sixth grade. A little more experience on this Orioles team than the Tigers right now.
Yes, and experience goes a long way, especially this age of kids. Young ones versus the older ones, you can seem to tell on the field.
Dunwoody draws a walk, and there was an errant throw down to third. Lutz, nice little bluff, but ball did not get away far enough to advance, so that keeps the force plays in play with one out. Bryce Abbott to the plate.
Runners on first and second for the Tigers with one out. Bryce Abbott swings and miss, had a great game last game with two triples, if I'm correct, hit in a couple runs, especially the first inning when Tigers scored five runs first inning.
Bryce will just be, he'll be moving into seventh grade next year. And Bryce right now is locked in very, very well at the plate. He's seeing the ball well and a big, strong kid. He can hit the ball with a lot of power. High fly ball.
Just missed it, but big swing. Could have been a pretty far hit, but good catch by the center fielder.
That's Blake Hughes with a catch out there in center field. So two outs now for the Tigers, and that's going to bring Peyton Hibner to the plate. Peyton also just finished fifth grade.
Ball low, gets away from the catcher, moves the runners to third and second base for the Tigers.
That's a big play right there. It takes your force out away. And it also sets up an opportunity if there's another pass ball for a potential run to score from third.
Potential run score, and just one base hit scores two runs instead of one if you move your runners back a base each.
Absolutely.
And as we know in the game of baseball and softball, any little play or advanced base could determine the game, even though it is 6 to 7 innings long sometimes. High ball to second base. We'll get the force out at first to end the inning for the Tigers. So good little threat by the Tigers in the first inning. We'll bring the Orioles up to bat in the bottom of the first inning. Abby Malko and, Todd Beeler. You're watching Rochester Youth League Baseball.
Rochester Telephone Company is hosting a photo contest for the cover of the new telephone directory. Get out your cameras, your smartphones, your Polaroids. It's time to take that winning picture. The theme for this year's cover is community. What image, what moment best captures the essence of Fulton County? Snap that photo and send it over to directory at rtc1.com. That's directory at rtc1.com.
Meet Bob and Stan. Both bought new TVs. Stan watches all the popular ringside live events, boxing, wrestling, and the big fight. Bob can't. Stan gets out-of-market sports packages of baseball, hockey, and basketball. Bob can't. Stan gets live concerts and the hottest Hollywood hits. What's the difference? Stan uses in-demand's pay-per-view for all the special events, sports programs, and the newest movie releases. So call RTC today and start your own pay-per-view experience.
Channel, Ma.
What channel is the Science Channel on?
We don't have that channel either, Ma.
How about the Hallmark Movie Channel?
Ma, we don't have any of those channels.
Well, why not?
Because we don't have digital tier.
So we don't have any of the digital tier channels?
Why do you think I'm always playing video games, Ma?
Because you don't have a girlfriend.
I chose a college with programs in the fastest growing fields.
And activities that keep me connected.
I chose a college where I could build a future.
Where instructors know their students by name.
I chose a college that prepares me for a career in 2 years or less.
Where I can transfer my credits toward a bachelor's degree.
I chose the most affordable option.
I chose Indiana's largest college.
Without sacrificing anything.
I am a success.
I am.
I am.
I am.
I am Ivy Tech Community College.
Classes start soon. Complete a free application today.
Welcome back to Rochester Youth League Baseball. Bottom of the first inning. Tigers did not score in the first inning, and this brings the Orioles' Andrew Miser to the plate.
Kane Lutz on the mound for the Tigers as that first pitch is fouled out of play. We talked about Kane just a little bit in the top half of the inning. Kane has 4 innings of pitching eligibility tonight. Normally, kids have 6 innings in a week. But this is a makeup game tonight. They'll play 2 games as part of a doubleheader, and therefore each pitcher has 2 more innings of eligibility tonight.
That makes sense, a rule I was not aware of.
Kane coming off a no-hit bid at Fulton earlier in the week. Pitched a great game, and that's his second no-hitter that he's pitched this year.
Ground ball to the third baseman, picked up cleanly and thrown to first base, not in time. And Andrew Miser will be safe at first base.
Set the defense for you for the Tigers. That's Elijah Yarber at third base, Bryce Abbott playing short, Andrew Bach at second, Brock Beeler at first, Andrew Dunwoody behind the plate, Kane Lutz on the mound. That's Evan Rentschler in left field. And there's a pop fly at shortstop. And Abbott bobbles the ball, but he's going to get a force play at second. That turns into a routine 6-4 fielder's choice.
And that is the third, maybe fourth time of this doubleheader that Andrew Miser has been thrown out at second base on a fielder's choice. So not much you can do there. You think the ball's going to be caught, so you're staying back at first to tag. And when he drops it, the defense gets lucky by getting the out at second base. But as a runner, you're kind of stuck in the middle.
Avery Gates at the plate now for the Orioles. First pitch up and away and gets by the catcher. So the runner, Gates, will head down to second. And I'm sorry, I said Gates was at the plate. It's Trey Stasiak. And finishing the defense for the Tigers, you've got Peyton Hidner out in center field and Noah Swango in right.
Swing and a miss by Trey Stasiak to even the count at 1. Avery Gates on second base. Andrew Miser thrown out on a fielder's choice at second base previously.
That pitch just missed down. 2 balls and a strike. Trey going into 7th grade next year. Good-looking young athlete. Can catch. Play just about anywhere in the field. And a very hard-throwing pitcher.
Yes, we saw that in the last inning, just watching the pitchers throughout the game, and Trey gets up, and he did have quite an arm. I was quite impressed with him when he was on the mound.
Well, I thought the Orioles did an excellent job. Their coaching staff mixed their pitchers up well and then brought Trey in for the closer role with a one-run lead, and he slammed the door.
He did a great job.
There's a foul pop and just falls safely out of play.
He will stay alive with two strikes, count 2-2 with teammate Avery Gates on second base. Excuse me. And speaking earlier about pitching rules, it's different. You know, I from a softball aspect, we don't have pitching rules. You know, softball players can throw all day, every day for a week as long as they have the stamina to do so. So here in the baseball, pitching rules is definitely something new.
Curveball just missed, and that'll take the count full. And, you know, Abby, you talk about the pitching and the restriction on the boys. With the girls, it's more of a natural underhand motion with a lot less wear and tear on the shoulder and the elbow.
Yep.
The boys throwing overhand, and it's a lot more torque on that shoulder and elbow. So it's a precautionary or a safety method to try to restrict how many pitches or innings that they throw in any given week.
And, too, being young, I mean, there's always rules whether you're in the majors or you're a young player, but, you know, you don't want to overthrow, especially, like you said, sixth grade, seventh graders. They want to have a long career as baseball players.
There's a shot that knocked Coach McCarter to the ground.
That was impressive reflexes by Coach McCarter over there, I will say so.
I hope you guys got that on video.
I hope so, too. See the replay on that later on.
Nathan Jacobs at the plate. Another good young athlete going into seventh grade next year. He comes up. Runners at first and second and one out. Another foul ball. That one straight back.
Straight back in the catcher's mask.
Kane throws a nice little, what I'll call a slurve. It's not a true curveball, not a lot of torque on the elbow, kind of throws it like a football with a lot of spin. He gets about 4 to 6 inches break, and right there it was. Froze Jacobs for strike three.
Called for strike three. That was a great pitch. And two, almost got Trey Stasiak the at-bat before because at two strikes, Trey's ducking, thinking the ball's going to hit him, and it just about caught the plate. So very, very nasty pitch by Kane Lutz.
That's a very effective pitch that at this age a lot of these kids aren't seeing. And like I said, it's got a lot of less amount of stretch than a traditional curveball on the young arm.
And pass ball will move the runners to third base and second base. That is Avery Gates and Trey Stasiak with brother Quinn Stasiak at the plate.
Swing and a miss by Quinn, and Quinn has been some kind of hot at the plate lately. It seems like every game I've seen down here, it's one hit after another for him.
When you're hot, might as well stay hot, because we know this game can be up and down as any.
Another swing and a miss.
And what I have noticed, too, just watching the young baseball players, when they swing and miss, they definitely don't get cheated. They are taking a big hack, and if they miss, they miss. But if they do connect, it's going a long way.
It's a sign of the times with the big leaguers right now, too.
Yes.
And there's a ball that gets through Abbott at shortstop into center field, and that will score two runs. So the Orioles scratch here first. Quinn stays hot and gives his team an early lead.
Base hit up the middle just off the glove of Abbott. But like we said, runners on second and third, whether you've got one out, two outs, or zero outs, just get a base hit up the middle and you'll score them both.
Grant McCarter at the plate now for the Orioles. And Grant, I'll tell you, 11 years old, maybe the best young first baseman I've seen in a long, long time. He can really, really pick it down there at first base.
And that's almost something when it's that young, they don't really learn it. They just kind of have that natural ability. So that's a great talent to have for Grant at that age.
Good young hitter, too. Got a lot of pop in that bat.
Low ball evens the count at one. Teammate Quinn Stasiak on first base as he cleared the bases with a base hit up the middle last at bat.
Now keep an eye on Quinn. You've got to stay on the base. There's no leadoffs in this league. You can't leave the bag until the ball crosses home plate or the batter makes contact. But with Quinn's speed, he could take off even if the catcher catches the ball cleanly and still make it.
Okay, so at this level of baseball, they can't take leadoffs?
That's correct.
Okay.
When they come up to Babe Ruth League as 13 years old, then they play high school rules and can take the leadoffs.
Okay, that makes sense. And counts 2-2 to Grant McCarter at the plate. One out for the Orioles.
And there's a swing and a miss. That was a swing and a miss to end the inning. Another rule here difference is there's no drop third strike rule in this league.
Okay. That makes sense. So no leadoffs, no drop third strikes. We are at the score of 2-0. The Orioles just scoring two runs in the bottom of the first inning. You're watching Rochester Youth League Baseball.
I chose a hands-on education.
The education I need to reach my goals.
I chose a college that's affordable.
That challenges me.
Where instructors put their students first.
I chose a college that offers online classes.
I chose a college that leads to a great career.
That prepared me for a career in nursing.
I am a problem solver.
I am the future.
I am.
I am.
I am.
I am.
I am Ivy Tech Community College.
Classes start soon. Complete a free application today.
Are you tired of your internet speed slowing you down? Not a problem. Get connected at the speed of light over RTC's advanced fiber optic network. Work, surf, or play on the net faster than ever before. Choose from multiple residential or business packages with speeds so fast, it'll have you flying away. Already have RTC's Fiber Connect internet? Upgrade your package today. RTC. Local services, local support, and local investments.
Choose a college that prepares you for success. A career that's meaningful. That ensures you reach your potential and increase your earnings. One that offers unique opportunities. Sparks your creativity. Challenges your imagination. And changes your perspective about learning. Start your career path at Indiana's most affordable college, Ivy Tech Community College.
Meet Bob and Stan. Both bought new TVs. Stan watches all the popular ringside live events, boxing, wrestling, and the big fight. Bob can't. Stan gets out-of-market sports packages of baseball, hockey, and basketball. Bob can't. Stan gets live concerts and the hottest Hollywood hits. What's the difference? Stan uses InDemand's pay-per-view for all the special events, sports programs, and the newest movie releases. So call RTC today and start your own pay-per-view experience.
Welcome back to Rochester Youth League Baseball on RTC TV. Top of the second inning, Abby Malko and Todd Beeler with me today. This is Elijah Yarber at the plate for the Tigers.
First pitch up and in. Avery Grates on the mound for the Orioles, entering his second inning of work tonight.
Second pitch inside for a ball. And off the air, I asked you about the run rule and time limit and inning length for baseball at this age. How does that work?
Well, a normal game at this level is six-inning ball game or an hour and 45 time limit. And the way the time limit works is no new inning would start after an hour and 45 minutes.
Okay.
Now, if the hour and 45 minutes expires during the middle of an inning, you will go ahead and finish that inning.
Okay.
So there's no disadvantage to either team in that aspect. Strike three called on Yarber. Nice job by Gates on the mound, and that'll bring Dalton Jackson to the plate. Now, tonight, Abby, we've got a little bit different situation. We've had some rain here in the last few weeks, and we've had to schedule some makeup games. And so what we decided to do tonight was to schedule a doubleheader between these teams to get our makeup game in. So
okay.
A little bit of a variation. We're playing five innings or 90 minutes. And so the first game, we did get all five innings in under the 90-minute time limit, and we're back into game two here tonight with the lights on. So kind of a nice little added benefit for the kids to play a little bit later under the lights, and that's something that we did a lot when I was young as a kid, but now we've got some out-of-town teams in the league. We travel a little bit, and the need to play the later games isn't quite as much as what it used to be.
Right. Well, everybody – no matter what age you are, loves to play under the lights. Just the atmosphere and the thought of it is just very cool. So cool that you scheduled a doubleheader and able to turn on the lights tonight for the boys.
Once school's out, you got a little more flexibility
yes.
with being able to do that. And it's an absolutely picture-perfect night out there, about 75 degrees, very little wind, light little cloud cover. So beautiful night for baseball.
I agree. And that will be ball three to make the count full to Jackson. A couple foul balls and a couple pitch balls by Avery Gates on the mound.
Jackson, he's a kid that this is his first year playing organized baseball, and he's done a really, really nice job of picking up things quickly, learning on the fly. You can see he's got a pretty good swing there. Mm-hmm. Just missed, swung right over the top of that ball for strike three. But the other night at Fulton, he hit a deep drive all the way to the fence in right center field. So that was a huge confidence builder.
Yes.
And something that he'll remember the rest of his life.
And crazy, too, sometimes how you could be in the worst slump or just not seeing the ball very well, but it just takes that one hit, the hit off the fence, the triple, just to get you rolling again.
Well, that's a crazy game.
Yes.
You can hit the ball right on the screws three or four times in a row right at somebody.
Yep.
For an out, and then you get one right off the end of the bat that bloops over a second baseman's head, and sometimes that's what gets you going on a streak.
Yep, falls in for a duck snort. It's crazy. You can't even be outcome oriented in this game. Is, I mean, take a great swing and sometimes the chips fall where they may because you can't control where you hit it at all times.
Well, that's one of the biggest things I think coaches need to remember at this level. Kids, they'll get an out and they'll hang their head, and
right.
You've got to talk them up and say, hey, one, you made contact, two, you moved the runners, you forced something to happen. And this is a game that you got to remember. Even the very, very best players of all time, you fail 70% of the time.
Exactly. And if you take that into any other game or even take it in the classroom, if I got a 30% on a test, I would be in big, big trouble. But hitting 300, 333, you're high in your conference no matter where you're at.
Nice line drive right back up the middle for Evan Rensler. So there's another kid who's steadily improved over the course of the season. And he's done some nice things. I think he's having a lot of fun playing baseball right now, and you can see the confidence growing.
And two, even though they're young, you know, you'd like to say it's about having fun. I play at the college level, and if it's still not about fun, then why are you there? You know, so just because they're young, it's always about fun. But I think almost take the kid aspect through high school, through college, and just you play it because you love it, and it always should be that way.
Well, that's one of the things that I really like about this league is, you know, these kids are out here playing with their friends and their buddies. And, you know, you watch these games, you see a lot of smiles.
Yep.
See a lot of friendly rivalries when best friends are facing off, you know,
yep,
at the plate against another one on the mound and so forth. And it's just a good, healthy atmosphere.
I agree. And two, the Orioles came back the last game after, you know, down by a couple runs. Came back 8-7, and watching you guys walk across and shake hands, no one, you know, obviously upset that you lose, but just smiles and high fives and, you know, let's go play another game. So that's always great to see good sportsmanship.
Well, I know, for example, you know, there were nice play by the catcher.
Yes, and good job.
Good recovery. I think that's Quinn Stasiak that's behind the plate.
Yep.
And he saved the runner from advancing. You know, I'll tell you, earlier today, two of the Oriole players were at my house all afternoon.
Right, right.
So,
And it's even a thing, too, where, you know, you play with these kids when you're younger, and you may not even be friends later on, but when you do see them, hey, I played with them when I was in the league, and she was my catcher when I pitched, you know. So even if you didn't grow up, but you were at different schools, you just kind of have that camaraderie of you're on the same team and all summer, and you're working toward the same goal and having a great time playing a game that you love.
Well, that's a whole other aspect to the All-Star tournaments or the travel ball circuit, is that you get to know so many kids from so many different schools.
Yep.
And you make all kinds of friends and acquaintances that really could last a lifetime and open a lot of doors and opportunities. So it goes way beyond just playing a game of baseball.
I agree, yes, especially being in the travel ball circuit. And there's girls, I would only see them in the summer, and I would be, you know, I could see them at the grocery store 5 years later and just smiles and a whole conversation, and we had just played a summer ball team together. So it's just very good friendships that get built.
Well, and you take a look, there's I think four kids on the diamond right now that are playing travel ball. They play in the local league whenever possible, and it's just a good time, and it really helps our future of our high school program.
Yep,
as well.
I agree.
Noah Swango grounds out to third base. Nice play to end the inning.
And that will end that for the Orioles, and the Tigers, the Orioles will go grab their bats You've been watching Rochester Youth League Baseball. I'm Abby Malka. With me tonight, Todd Beeler on RTC TV.
Daddy! What channel is the Family Network on?
We don't have that channel, Ma.
What channel is the Science Channel on?
We don't have that channel either, Ma.
How about the Hallmark Movie Channel?
Ma, we don't have any of those channels.
Well, why not?
Because we don't have digital tier.
So we don't have any of the digital tier channels?
Why do you think I'm always playing video games, Ma?
Because you don't have a girlfriend.
I chose a hands-on education.
The education I need to reach my goals.
I chose a college that's affordable.
That challenges me.
Where instructors put their students first.
I chose a college that offers online classes.
I chose a college that leads to a great career.
That prepared me for a career in nursing.
I am a problem solver.
I am the future.
I am.
I am.
I am.
I am.
I am Ivy Tech Community College.
Classes start soon. Complete a free application today.
Rochester Telephone Company is hosting a photo contest for the cover of the new telephone directory. Get out your cameras, your smartphones, your Polaroids. It's time to take that winning picture. The theme for this year's cover is community. What image, what moment best captures the essence of Fulton County? Snap that photo and send it over to directory at rtc1.com. That's directory at rtc1.com.
Are you tired of your internet speed slowing you down? Not a problem. Get connected at the speed of light over RTC's advanced fiber optic network. Work, surf, or play on the net faster than ever before. Choose from multiple residential or business packages with speeds so fast, it'll have you flying away. Already have RTC's Fiber Connect internet? Upgrade your package today. RTC. Local services, local support, and local investments.
Welcome back to Rochester Youth League Baseball on RTC TV. This is the bottom of the second inning. I'm Abby Malko, and with me tonight is Todd Beeler. And up to bat first for the Orioles is Eli Stevens as he takes ball one.
Eli Stevens pitched the middle three innings for the Orioles in game number one tonight, and he did a phenomenal job at keeping the Tigers at bay, keeping his team in the game, and that led to an eventual comeback win by the Orioles late in the ballgame. And Eli's a kid that really the last couple of years has started to see more time on the mound, and he has improved dramatically. Good, hardworking kid, and can swing the bat well. He's a big, strong kid for his age. Shanks went out of play there for strike two. And he's another one of the younger kids out here tonight. He's just finished fifth grade.
And like you said, just got some time on the mound and really came along. Just it goes back to just confidence and being in the game situation and just confidence doing well in your position.
And there's a swing and a miss. Nice job of burying a low fastball at the knees. So Kane Lutz picks up a strikeout. And that will bring Blake Hughes to the plate.
And Blake Hughes had a huge hit the last game. Bases loaded, triple to the right field corner. And if you're a right-handed batter, the right field corner is your place if you want to get a triple. So he cleared the bases, and I think he ended up tying the game the last inning. So good hit by Blake.
He most certainly did. He got a fastball that was up and away. He got those long arms out and got the meat of the bat on it and drove that ball all the way down in the corner, and that ended up being the hit of the ball game.
Yep, I would agree with you. And as it happened, I didn't want to jinx it, didn't want to say too much, but I figured that would be close to the hit, if not the hit of the game.
Nice curveball for strike three. So Lutz, two up, two down. Good start here in the bottom of the second. And Maverick Cox will come to the plate. Maverick, another kid that just finished fifth grade, and he hits one straight back and out of play for strike one.
And great job, too, by Kane Lutz. Always ahead in the count if he doesn't get a strike called. Usually the batters are fouling off the pitches, so he's very aggressive in attacking the Oriole hitters.
Well, Kane is a strike-throwing machine. And there he paints one on the outside corner for strike two. So he started up and in with a fastball for strike one, came low and away with a fastball for strike two, and I think we're going to see the hook And that one stayed up a little bit. Maverick tattooed it, but way out of play down the left field side.
And great swing by Maverick. And as a pitcher, you know, you're doing well, but you see a batter just smoke one down the third baseline, and that makes you think for a second, you know, what pitch am I going to throw? Because he is able to get the meat on the bat and just smoke the ball.
I'd see an offside pitch away right here. And Dunwoody's setting up on the outside corner.
Good call.
And that was a fastball instead of a changeup, but it did miss a little bit outside for ball one.
And what's your philosophy? Do you think if you've got two strikes on a batter, do you mess with them and throw one out to see if they chase if you've got no balls and two strikes?
There's strike three. Well, I'll tell you what, we'll come back and discuss that in the next segment because we just finished inning number two.
That sounds great. You've been watching Rochester Youth League Baseball on RTC TV. Abby Malko with me tonight, Todd Beeler. We'll catch you in a half inning.
Daddy! What channel is the Family Network on?
We don't have that channel, Ma.
What channel is the Science Channel on?
We don't have that channel either, Ma.
How about the Hallmark Movie Channel?
Ma, we don't have any of those channels.
Well, why not?
Because we don't have digital tier.
So we don't have any of the digital tier channels?
Why do you think I'm always playing video games, Ma?
Because you don't have a girlfriend.
Choose a college that prepares you for success. A career that's meaningful. That ensures you reach your potential and increase your earnings. One that offers unique opportunities. Sparks your creativity. Challenges your imagination. And changes your perspective about learning. Start your career path at Indiana's most affordable college, Ivy Tech Community College.
I chose a college with programs in the fastest growing fields.
And activities that keep me connected.
I chose a college where I could build a future.
Where instructors know their students by name.
I chose a college that prepares me for a career in 2 years or less.
Where I can transfer my credits toward a bachelor's degree.
I chose the most affordable option.
I chose Indiana's largest college.
Without sacrificing anything.
I am a success.
I am.
I am.
I am.
I am. Ivy Tech Community College.
Classes start soon. Complete a free application today.
I chose a hands-on education.
The education I need to reach my goals.
I chose a college that's affordable.
That challenges me.
Where instructors put their students first.
I chose a college that offers online classes.
I chose a college that leads to a great career.
That prepared me for a career in nursing.
I am a problem solver.
I am the future.
I am.
I am.
I am.
I am.
I am Ivy Tech Community College.
Classes start soon. Complete a free application today.
Welcome back to Rochester Youth League Baseball on RTC TV. I'm Abby Malko, and with me tonight is Todd Beeler. And right before the end of the inning, asked Todd about his philosophy when it comes to pitching. If you've got an 0-2 count on a batter, Todd, what do you think? Do you mess with them and throw one out to make them chase? Do you throw it up and in and make them duck? Or do you just lay it on them and strike three, you're out?
Well, I'm going to cop out and give you a little bit of a defensive answer, and that is it depends on the situation.
Right.
And Schaefer pushes a bunt, but right to the first baseman, Eli Stevens, who applies the tag for out number one. You know, if it's a leadoff batter or no one's on base, a lot of times I like to go ahead and try to attack that and get that out. Now, that doesn't mean throw the ball down the middle.
Right.
Throw something off speed, throw stuff
hit your pitch.
Out of the strike zone. Yes, hit the pitcher's pitch, but try to go ahead and get that out and save some pitches and some energy from the pitcher. There's a ball hit to deep short by Kane Lutz, and he beats that out for an infield single. Now, if you've got runners on base, you might need to go more with a waste pitch or get them to chase a little bit more, but you want to be a little more cognizant of throwing that ball down in the dirt. And again, you've got to take a look at what kind of a catcher you've got up there, too, and
right.
How reliable they are.
Right. So usually, yeah, as far as our softball pitching theory goes, we try and first pitch strike as much as we can, but definitely most of the time we try and make them chase if we've got an 0-2 count.
Well, I'll agree with you all day long that most important pitch in baseball or softball
Yes. Is
strike one.
Yes, I agree. Especially, and as a hitter too, I know some hitters like to get in the box and kind of, you know, take their time. Let's see a first pitch, you know, see how it goes. If it's a first pitch strike, then you only, you know, you foul off your second one, you're down 0-2. So as a hitter, it's not very comfortable having a first pitch strike thrown at you aggressively.
And 3-0 now is the count. Brock Beeler at the plate. Kane Lutz advanced very nicely. A ball in the dirt that was blocked very well by Quinn Stasiak. Kept it in front. Lutz, very aggressive, took the extra bag. And the throw down was right on the money, but Kane did an excellent job picking up an extra base. And Brock Beeler draws a base on balls.
And I think this is his fourth walk out of four at-bats on the day, if I'm correct.
Yeah, he's not seen a whole lot to swing at here tonight.
Yes, and it wasn't even, you know, full counts he was battling. He was being pitched three balls straight in a row, and he'd get a strike in ball number four. So looking at the stats from last game, he always seemed to be on first base, and I'm thinking, man, he's hitting like crazy, but he's just walking all day.
Well, one of his strengths is that he has a pretty good command of the strike zone.
And I think that helps, too, that he's a pitcher. Your eye is better, and you know on the day, you know, he pitched the first game, you know what the umpire's calling. So a strike that could be a strike in another game, the umpire's not calling inside, he's got a better eye for that.
Well, and the other thing, he's a pretty good little catcher, too.
Yes.
So, you know, that's a pretty good combination with having a good batter's eye up there.
I agree, and I think, you know, kudos to him for taking the walk. Some people get impatient, and they think, man, I want to hit it. Heck, if someone walked me all day long and my on-base percentage is great, I'll take the strikes and swing at them when they're there, but if you're not going to pitch to me, then I'm going to make you pay and definitely draw the walk. So great job by Brock on that.
Gates, a good job getting ahead here, and then an inside pitch caught Dunwoody right there on the helmet. So Andrew wears one for the team. And that'll load the bases with one out. Tigers trying to mount a threat here in the top of the third.
And I think, like we talked about, walks and errors and even hit by pitches are huge when you're a pitcher as confidence, you know, just demoralizing. Like, you're a little more tighter, but, you know, that's somebody on a free base if you hit them.
Well, biggest at bat of the game right here for the Tigers. They've not yet had that big two-out hit here early in the game or that timely hit. Only one out in this situation, but bases loaded with big Bryce Abbott at the plate. This is the guy you want here, and there's nowhere to put him. And so far, he's kind of helped Gates out a little bit. He's chased two pitches that really weren't a hitter's pitch.
And as Gates, as the pitcher, thinking, okay, got a big guy who can swing the bat. He's our number four hitter, and I got the bases loaded with one out. So I'm sure swinging at those two strikes definitely made Gates pretty happy.
That one missed inside. Gates, you know, he's throwing with a lot of confidence out there. And you look at him, he's got a smile on his face. He's having fun. And he's telling Bryce, I'm coming right at you, buddy.
Exactly.
There's a topper. Gates fumbles it. Cannot make the play at the plate. And the Tigers scratch for the first time tonight.
And that will score Lutz from third base. Beeler moves to third. Dunwoody at second. And Abbott at first base.
So same scenario here, one out, bases loaded, and Peyton Hibner coming to the plate.
And crazy play, you know, it's a pretty soft hit ball, and if you're on the Tiger side, you're booking it home because all he's got to do is step on the plate as the catcher. But, you know, just a tad too late or a bobble on the ball, then the Tigers end up scoring.
Well, Gates aggressively charged that ball, and you'll see there's that dirt cutout, the lane between the mound and home plate, the ball edged into the grass, and Gates slipped a little bit as he went to try to make that play, and that allowed the Tigers to scratch across the first run, and Gates right back with strike one more time.
And earlier, talking about body language with the pitcher, that's also something crazy I think that affects so much of the game, especially baseball and softball being slower games, and if you could, you probably could fall asleep out in center field sometimes if you're not getting action. So when you're a pitcher and, you know, you are smiling and you're, you know, bouncing around the mound, as a hitter, that's intimidating as well.
Well, you know, the mental aspect of this game is just absolutely huge.
Yes.
And a pitcher can help his defense tremendously by working quickly and confidently out there. That helps keep the infielders and the outfielders on their toes, keeps them moving, keeps them more engaged, where pitchers that are more deliberate, as you said, can very easily lull players in the field to sleep.
Yep, I agree. So, and it's in this game, definitely a team game, but the pitcher controls so much as far as the tempo and the confidence of the team and how the team honestly can do that day. I say, you know, with the, however the pitcher goes, everybody else goes. Now, if you have to, yes, you can pick up your pitcher, but how nice is it if you've got some guy on the mound who's confident as ever and he's going aggressively at the batters, then the whole team just kind of follows along with him.
Yep, absolutely. You couldn't be more correct. 2-2 count here. Hibner at the plate. And that one just missed. Apparently it was a 3-2 count. So that will be a bases loaded walk, an RBI for Hibner, and we've got a tie ball game all of a sudden.
That is a tie very quickly. And like we said, walks, especially with bases loaded being a dangerous place because you don't want to pitch to them and have them clear the bases, but walking in a run is never a good thing either.
Well, here's a big strike zone coming to the plate. And Yarber fouls it off to the right side out of play. Elijah Yarber, he'll be going into seventh grade next year. I'm not sure how tall he is. He looks like he's approaching 8 foot tall already.
I think so.
As a 12-year-old. But good kid. Very tall, very lanky. Has swung the bat pretty well this year. And he comes up in a key situation in this ball game.
One out and bases loaded. And two, like you're saying, Yarber being lanky, a lot of people think, you know, in baseball and softball, the big brute strength kids are the ones who can pound the ball. I've seen a lot of girls on the softball end who have the length and the whip on the bat that they could be scrawny little sticks, but if they're tall, they can make the ball fly as well.
Yeah, there's no doubt about that. There's an 0-2 pitch fouled back. It's right. It's physics. It's mechanics. And one thing that people totally don't think about is the pitcher supplies the majority of the power.
Right.
So if you have the mechanics and if you can square the ball up properly, that ball will jump.
I agree. Some people take 110% swings and their mechanics are off and they're not going anywhere. But the kid who swings 75% with a perfect swing makes it fly pretty often.
Well, you're a pretty good example of that. Here's a wild pitch, runner trying to come home, and he is under it. The ball was there in plenty of time, but the tag was applied on top of the plate. So Andrew Dunwood, he slid under it, foot was on the plate before the tag was applied, and the Tigers take the third run of the ball game.
And that's a big call, definitely sliding under it. You saw that he tagged almost his waist and his arm, and his feet were underneath.
Well, I was going to try to pay you some props, Abby. I was going to say that you're a prime example of someone that is not a huge hulking brute out on the softball diamond, and you've been able to successfully hit with some nice pop over your career.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that. And that is a walk, wild pitch, a couple mix-ups on the base paths.
And there's an out at second, but the Tigers will steal another run, and there's another wild throw out in the center field. But Yarber won't advance anymore, so try to recap that.
Yes.
There was a wild pitch. It ricocheted down the first base line. Quinn Stasiak, the catcher, did an excellent job of pouncing on that ball quickly. The runner, Bryce Abbott at third, thought about coming home, decided he'd better put on the brakes. Well, Hibner, the runner behind him, was about on top of him at third base. They threw in behind Hibner at second for an out. That allowed Abbott to score. And when they threw home, that allowed Yarber to advance from first to second. So
I'm trying to play catch up. That was two runs scored on that play. Is that correct?
That was two runs scored on that play.
So that makes it five runs in a row for the Tigers with a couple errors and a couple nice slides by the Tigers.
That's right. Very aggressive base running here has paid some dividends. They gave up an out that time, but they stole two runs.
Right. And just especially making another team kind of go crazy and throw the ball around. You know, it gets thrown into center, and Yarber could have tried to go to third base. He knows himself better as far as speed-wise. But just being able to cause chaos on the base paths and have the Orioles throw the ball around is something good for the Tigers.
Well, I'll trade an out for two runs any day of the week in this
game. I agree. Call them sacrifices for a reason.
All right. Dalton Jackson will now be the hitter for the Tigers with two outs. Elijah Yarber, the runner, at second.
And five straight runs, like I said earlier, for the Tigers in the top of the third inning here.
Well, I'll tell you what, Avery Gates for the Orioles has pitched a very nice game. He's throwing a lot of strikes. And the difference this inning as opposed to the first two innings, Tigers have done a pretty good job of, one, putting the ball in play and forcing the Orioles to play some defense, and, two, they've been a little more patient at the plate, trying to swing at the hitter's pitches instead of helping the pitcher out.
I agree. And as a pitcher, you got to let your defense do the work. You definitely don't want to be floating them down the middle, but as long as you can throw strikes on the corners, your defense has to be able to make some plays.
Well, and that's a big thing we try to teach kids at this age is – it's not about throwing, you know, the knuckle curve and all
right.
kinds of, you know, wild, crazy gyro pitches. It's being able to locate your fastball up, down, in, out, and then change speeds.
Right.
And the change of speeds really is with a grip. It's the same motion. It's the same arm speed. And the difference is just the grip of the ball. And if they can master that, they can change speeds and hit their spots, they're going to be very tough to beat at this age. And really, that's really the key component. It doesn't matter whether it's softball or baseball at
yep.
any level.
I definitely agree with you, especially teaching them young just the basics. And they can, as long as you have the basics and the core, you can always build on it from there.
Jackson has worked the count full with 2 outs.
Runner in scoring position with Yarber on second base.
Evan Rentzler awaits on deck.
A little communication between pitcher and catcher here. Full count, 2 outs. Runner on second base for the Tigers. Big inning for the Tigers at the top of the third. Scoring 5 innings here right in a row.
The payoff pitch, and that one bounces before it gets to the catcher, and Jackson works a walk. So now, that's not the end of the world, because you set up a force play now at any bag.
Yep.
So, you know, a difference is a ground ball down to third. Third baseman just has to knock the ball down. He's got plenty of time, and he's got a force, as opposed to making a long throw clear across the diamond.
Right. And like we said, walks are never good, but they are acceptable when the base is open. Yarber was already on second base, so the walk didn't push him in scoring position. The base was open.
Rentzler, ground ball to short, and that's Hughes, who will flip the ball over to Grant McCarter at third for the final out of the inning.
And big inning for the Tigers, scoring 5 runs. The score is now 5-2. Tigers in the lead. We will head to the bottom of the third inning. Abby Malco here with me tonight, Todd Beeler. You've been watching Rochester Youth League Baseball on RTC TV.
Rochester Telephone Company is hosting a photo contest for the cover of the new telephone directory. Get out your cameras, your smartphones, your Polaroids. It's time to take that winning picture. The theme for this year's cover is community. What image, what moment best captures the essence of Fulton County? Snap that photo and send it over to directory@rtc1.com. That's directory@rtc1.com.
Meet Bob and Stan. Both bought new TVs. Stan watches all the popular ringside live events, boxing, wrestling, and the big fight. Bob can't. Stan gets out-of-market sports packages of baseball, hockey, and basketball. Bob can't. Stan gets live concerts and the hottest Hollywood hits. What's the difference? Stan uses InDemand's pay-per-view for all the special events, sports programs, and the newest movie releases. So call RTC today and start your own pay-per-view experience.
Are you tired of your internet speed slowing you down? Not a problem. Get connected at the speed of light over RTC's advanced fiber optic network. Work, surf, or play on the net faster than ever before. Choose from multiple residential or business packages with speeds so fast, it'll have you flying away. Already have RTC's Fiber Connect internet? Upgrade your package today. RTC. Local services, local support, and local investments.
I chose a hands-on education.
The education I need to reach my goals.
I chose a college that's affordable.
That challenges me.
Where instructors put their students first.
I chose a college that offers online classes.
I chose a college that leads to a great career.
That prepared me for a career in nursing.
I am a problem solver.
I am the future.
I am.
I am.
I am.
I am.
I am Ivy Tech Community College.
Classes start soon. Complete a free application today.
Hi. Welcome back to Rochester Youth League Baseball on RTC TV. I'm Abby Malco, and here with me tonight is Todd Beeler. This is the bottom of the third inning, and up to bat for the Orioles is Trey Hardesty.
And Trey hits the first pitch right back to the box. Kane Lutz snags it, flips it over to Brock Beeler at first for out number one.
Which good snag by Brock Beeler as well. And what's your theory? You know, we've talked about pitching and first pitch strikes. What about as a hitter? Do you, after your first at bat, do you watch a pitch? Do you attack it if it's there? What do you think about that?
Well, my philosophy on the hitter is you want him to go up and be aggressive. And
yep.
Here's a ground ball, weakly hit to third. Yarber picks it up. Nice snag out of the dirt
very
by Brock
nice.
At first, but the hitter, that's Christian Button, did a nice job legging it out for an infield single.
But very nice scoop. If that gets away and gets behind to the fence, that could be a double on an error. So good grab by Brock.
That'll go back to the top of the order for Aaron Miser. And, you know, back to the question you ask about hitting, I like to see the hitters be selectively aggressive. There's a fly ball to right field, hit high. Noah Swango, nice catch out there in right field for out number two.
Very nice catch. Coming in hard and just grabbed it on his glove side. And big play because it keeps the Orioles at first base with two outs now. Go ahead.
Aggressively charged that ball, got
yes.
an excellent jump, and was Johnny on the spot.
Well, and that's one of those balls we've seen in the past game, too. There was about three bloop hits behind the second base and the shortstop. They fell in for hits, but as a defense, those are frustrating because is that the outfielder's ball? Is that the infielder's ball? But very good job being aggressive by the right fielder on Swango grabbing that out.
A big hitter at the plate here. Trey Stasiak hits the pitch right at shortstop to Abbott. He'll fire across, and that one's in the dirt, and Brock can't pick that one out. And Stasiak safe at first on the infield error. You know, going back to the question you asked, though, you know, I said that I like to see the kids be selectively aggressive. They go up there with an idea in their mind of a little bit of a box. You know, where do they really like to hit the ball? And that needs to be in about a 4 to 6 inch imaginary box. And if that pitch is there, you're loaded up and ready to explode on it. If it's anywhere else, you let it go. Early in the count,
right.
You need to be hitting your pitch and not helping the pitcher out.
Yep, I agree.
There's a base hit right side. Trey Stasiak reached out, hit that ball in the perfect spot, and that's going to bring Aaron Miser home for the Orioles' third run of the game. I'm sorry, that was Button that scored. Christian Button scoring that run.
And that is three runs for the Orioles. And that puts Avery Gates at third base and Trey Stasiak at first.
Nathan Jacobs, the cleanup hitter at the plate now for the Orioles. Ball one outside. And in a first and third situation there, Trey Stasiak knows that he can just take second base. It's highly doubtful that the catcher's going to throw down and risk a late or an errant throw, allowing that runner on third to easily score.
Right.
That ball two that misses low and away.
And two outs for the Orioles, but two in scoring position with the number four hitter up to bat. Dangerous position for Kane Lutz, but seems to be handling it well.
There's a swing and a miss. Nathan Jacobs, about 2 weeks ago, had a career first. He hit a ball over the scoreboard in dead center field. On this field for a very long home run. And there's a ball that eludes Andrew Bach at second. And that's going to play two more runs. And Jacobs moves up quickly to second base on the play. And just like that, we've got a new ball game again.
And ball just past the second baseman, but like we said, doesn't matter if there's no outs or two outs. A base hit anywhere in this game that we play can score two runs if it's in the right position. So now the Orioles take the lead by a score of 5-4.
Quinn Stasiak at the plate now. Another dangerous hitter. That ball right back to the mound. Lutz over to Beeler at first for the out. And that will retire the side.
So we will head to the top of the fourth inning here. You've been watching Rochester Youth League Baseball on RTC TV. Abby Malco and Todd Beeler. We'll talk to you in a bit.
I chose a hands-on education.
The education I need to reach my goals.
I chose a college that's affordable.
That challenges me.
Where instructors put their students first.
I chose a college that offers online classes.
I chose a college that leads to a great career.
That prepared me for a career in nursing.
I am a problem solver.
I am the future.
I am.
I am.
I am.
I am.
I am Ivy Tech Community College.
Classes start soon. Complete a free application today.
Are you tired of your internet speed slowing you down? Not a problem. Get connected at the speed of light over RTC's advanced fiber optic network. Work, surf, or play on the net faster than ever before. Choose from multiple residential or business packages with speeds so fast, it'll have you flying away. Already have RTC's Fiber Connect internet? Upgrade your package today. RTC. Local services, local support, and local investments.
Choose a college that prepares you for success. A career that's meaningful. That ensures you reach your potential and increase your earnings. One that offers unique opportunities. Sparks your creativity. Challenges your imagination. And changes your perspective about learning. Start your career path at Indiana's most affordable college, Ivy Tech Community College.
Meet Bob and Stan. Both bought new TVs. Stan watches all the popular ringside live events, boxing, wrestling, and the big fight. Bob can't. Stan gets out-of-market sports packages of baseball, hockey, and basketball. Bob can't. Stan gets live concerts and the hottest Hollywood hits. What's the difference? Stan uses InDemand's pay-per-view for all the special events, sports programs, and the newest movie releases. So call RTC today and start your own pay-per-view experience.
Welcome back to Rochester Youth League Baseball on RTC TV. Abby Malko here with me tonight, Todd Beeler, and this is the top of the fourth inning, Orioles versus the Tigers. Score is 5-4 right now.
And the Orioles in the lead here, and Andrew Bach is at the plate right now. Noah Swango is on deck, and Jordan Schaefer is in the hole. So the Tigers once again find themselves needing a little bit of a comeback here. And Trey Stasiak is the new pitcher for the Orioles.
I'm talking about Trey earlier, kind of being a closer and having a really good arm. See how the Tigers adjust.
Well, Trey's got a live arm, came in and closed the game, got the save in game number one tonight, pitched one very effective inning. And he's going to be asked to pitch the final two innings here to close this one out here in the nightcap. Bach with a swing and fouled it straight back to stay alive. One ball, two strike count.
And when it comes to balancing the pitchers and their innings, does your schedule ever randomly throw a game, like a makeup game later in the week? Like if they use Trey tonight, do they know for a fact they won't play anymore and need him for the rest of the week, or how does that work?
Yeah. When the schedule's made at the beginning of the year, the major league that we're viewing here tonight every team is scheduled to play two games a week.
Okay.
So each pitcher can pitch a maximum of six innings in the course of that week. Now, as we mentioned earlier, we're playing a doubleheader tonight as part of a makeup, a rainout game we had earlier in the year. And this is the third game for each of the teams here this week. So we have allowed two extra innings per pitcher here tonight. So we try to compensate for that.
And just watching that foul ball went off the face mask of Quinn Stasiak, I think. And this might be his second potential injury of the night when he was at shortstop diving back in the first inning of the game. He hurt himself but came back in the game. So I think just probably rattled his head a little bit, or maybe even hit his chest protector pretty hard. But he is getting talked to by his dad, maybe walking off a pitch that was hit back at him.
Well, Quinn's a player that knows no fear. He has some unbelievable natural athletic ability. And you mentioned in that first game, early in that ball game, he was at shortstop and went out into short left center field, tried to make a very spectacular athletic catch and dove and landed awkwardly on his shoulder. Had to come out for, I think he actually sat out two innings, went back in the game late in the game at second base, had a similar little bloop over his head.
Yep.
Into shallow right field. Just all-out dive again for the ball. Yes. That time he comes up with a really, really big out for his team.
And two, that's important, like you said, playing with no fear. Sometimes, you know, people, human nature, you get hurt doing one play, and they're a little skittish on the second play, but he just flew back and made the catch. But, you know, just knowing Trey, or knowing Quinn and Trey both, being a basketball player for Coach Stasiak, watching them in the auxiliary gym leap from the highest bleacher possible to the floor while we're trying to have basketball practice, just boys being boys, and like you said, their natural athletic ability and not having fear just kind of comes in their work and their play.
Well, the Orioles, fortunately, are definitely not hurting at the catcher position. They've got at least four very solid kids that can put on the equipment and back up the plate. Aaron Miser very quickly gets dressed, and he will fill that role now probably for the remainder of the game. So Andrew Bach back into the box. Two ball, two strike count. Nobody out, nobody on here in the top of the fourth. Tigers looking to get a little rally going. Oh, nice shot right back up the middle.
Nice, very nice hit up the middle. And almost, I think, maybe tipped the glove of Trey Stasiak as a pitcher, but great line drive. And I was going to ask you right before, you know, what does that do as a batter? You know, the count's 2-2, you got to pause for an injury or a lineup switch. You know, does that take you out of your rhythm? But obviously not for Bach, because he comes in and hits a line drive. So I think the break could be good or bad depending on the hitter.
Well, in that case, it obviously was good. It cleared his head, and he was sitting dead red on a fastball. He got it, and he ripped it.
And Swango up to bat now for the Tigers with Bach on first base. Still no outs. Orioles in the lead by one run.
Swango, a very nice catch out in right field a little bit early in this ball game. And quickly in the hole, 0-2. So Trey's out there. He's just firing BBs and challenging these hitters to do something with it.
I agree. And he seems to have one of the better arms on the field here tonight from the pitchers we've seen. And that definitely plays into his hands well.
Nice job by Swango. Fights off a nasty pitch down and in to stay alive.
And as a batter right now, you're 0-2. You want to have a good eye because you don't want to chase on a bad pitch. But, you know, like they say, anything close, you got to take a swing and just hope to fight off the rough strikes and hit the good strike if they give you one.
And he fouls off another pitch to stay alive. I'll tell you what, you know, the 0-2 count as a hitter is one of the most difficult thing in all of sports.
Yep.
You got balls that can be coming at you at 90 miles an hour. You could have a breaking pitch that comes in at 75 miles an hour.
Yep.
And there's a fine line between what's a strike and a ball. So you're right. You've got to be very aggressive. You've got to expand that zone, and you only have a split second to make up your mind whether I'm attacking that pitch or whether I've got to lay off.
And I think that's the hardest part, because you have two strikes, so I'm swinging, wins the point where you let off and release, and like that, maybe you think it's a ball, but close enough where the umpire calls it strikes three and you're headed back to the dugout.
Well, you bring up an excellent point there, and that's the mentality of a hitter.
Mm-hmm.
You have to go to the plate thinking, yes, yes, yes,
yep,
I'm going to unload and just, you know, hit this ball as hard as I can. And then when it's not in the zone, you got to tell yourself at the very last instance, no.
And the brakes.
And lay off that.
The brakes have to be slammed so fast because you're going 90 miles an hour, and then you have to stop your hands, like you said, within a split second. So,
well, if you don't load up and get in a position to hit that ball, you know, you can't do it in reverse. You can't
right.
at the last second say yes.
Exactly.
Because there's no way that you can time that thing up and get your body and your hands and your bat in a position to make solid contact.
Yes, that's just, honestly, you probably should just walk back to the dugout in that case, because that's just not a good place to be either.
And these are just the simple things that we try to teach the kids, you know, about the game and the approach to the game. And it's all about trying to put them in the best possible positions to be successful. So Schaefer goes down on strikes there. Stasiak, an excellent job of firing nothing but strikes right now. We're back to the top of the order with Kane Lutz. And that pitch got away from the catcher. Bach moves up into scoring position. That's an important play right there, because, one, you remove a force play at
yep.
second base, and, two, now you have a runner in scoring position. Lutz hits the ball into the outfield. More than likely, we've got a tie ball game.
And I think, too, just that play up the middle can be so dangerous sometimes.
Yep. He's thrown out. There's a pitch that got by the catcher but ricocheted right back, and Miser fired a strike down there to third base, and Eli Stevens applied the tag for the final out of the inning.
And we will finish my thought on the force out up the middle play when we are back to the bottom of the fourth inning. Todd Beeler and Abby Malco here tonight at the Rochester Youth Baseball League. You've been watching on RTC TV.
Rochester Telephone Company is hosting a photo contest for the cover of the new telephone directory. Get out your cameras, your smartphones, your Polaroids. It's time to take that winning picture. The theme for this year's cover is community. What image, what moment best captures the essence of Fulton County? Snap that photo and send it over to directory@rtc1.com. That's directory@rtc1.com.
Meet Bob and Stan. Both bought new TVs. Stan watches all the popular ringside live events, boxing, wrestling, and the big fight. Bob can't. Stan gets out-of-market sports packages of baseball, hockey, and basketball. Bob can't. Stan gets live concerts and the hottest Hollywood hits. What's the difference? Stan uses InDemand's pay-per-view for all the special events, sports programs, and the newest movie releases. So call RTC today and start your own pay-per-view experience.
Daddy! What channel is the Family Network on?
We don't have that channel, Ma.
What channel is the Science Channel on?
We don't have that channel either, Ma.
How about the Hallmark Movie Channel?
Ma! We don't have any of those channels.
Well, why not?
Because we don't have digital tier.
So we don't have any of the digital tier channels?
Why do you think I'm always playing video games, Ma?
Because you don't have a girlfriend.
I chose a college with programs in the fastest growing fields.
And activities that keep me connected.
I chose a college where I could build a future.
Where instructors know their students by name.
I chose a college that prepares me for a career in 2 years or less.
Where I can transfer my credits toward a bachelor's degree.
I chose the most affordable option.
I chose Indiana's largest college.
Without sacrificing anything.
I am a success.
I am.
I am.
I am.
I am Ivy Tech Community College.
Classes start soon. Complete a free application today.
Welcome back to Rochester Youth League Baseball on RTC TV. Tigers versus Orioles, bottom of the fourth inning here at Rochester City Baseball Field. And the first pitch is high for a ball.
And Abby, we've got a new pitcher in the ballgame for the Tigers. That's Andrew Bach, who moves in from second base to toe the slab. Kane Lutz did a very good job through his three innings pitched, and he'll just make a straight switch and go over to second base.
Big hack by Grant McCarter to even the count at 1-1.
A couple of really good friends right here, pitching and hitting right here. And so little extra added friendly rivalry here. Bach, nice job. Shot to second. Lutz knocks it down. Throws to Beeler in time for the out.
Very nice play.
McCarter tried to go in low and slide into first base, but I don't think it matters whether he slid or whether he ran through it.
And I've
excellent play by Lutz in shallow right field.
And I've always wondered that theory, you know, does it look faster if you slide? I mean, you know, you're running through anyway. You know, you see people do that every now and then, but I guess it's just the reaction of the play to try and get to first as fast as you can.
Well, conventional wisdom is, and there's a ball, fly ball, center field, Peyton Hibner underneath it,
nice.
Makes the catch. Excellent contact by Eli Stevens, just really got underneath it a little bit. Hibner, excellent job of getting right underneath the ball and making the catch for the second out of the inning.
Yes, very good catch.
And back to the point that we were making, though, what point were we making?
About running through first or diving at first. Yes.
Well, conventional wisdom tells you never slide or dive head first into first base.
Yes.
With the one exception. And that is if you see that the throw is offline and it's coming up the line towards
right.
the catcher, then it would be acceptable to slide or dive to try to avoid the tag.
Yep.
But otherwise, it is a force play. And here's a fly ball hit to left field. And that ball
nice.
Is caught by Jordan Schaefer. Excellent
Great
defensive
grab.
Inning for the Tigers.
And that was – I haven't seen many fly balls to the outfield this game, but – two very good catches, and he came in a little too far and grabbed it right behind his head. So great job for the Tigers defensively. They will head to the dugout to grab their bats. You've been watching Rochester Youth League Baseball. I'm Abby Malco. With me tonight, Todd Beeler on RTC TV.
Daddy! What channel is the Family Network on?
We don't have that channel, Ma.
What channel is the Science Channel on?
We don't have that channel either, Ma.
How about the Hallmark Movie Channel?
Ma, we don't have any of those channels.
Well, why not?
Because we don't have digital tier.
So we don't have any of the digital tier channels?
Why do you think I'm always playing video games, Ma?
Because you don't have a girlfriend.
I chose a hands-on education.
The education I need to reach my goals.
I chose a college that's affordable.
That challenges me.
Where instructors put their students first.
I chose a college that offers online classes.
I chose a college that leads to a great career.
That prepared me for a career in nursing.
I am a problem solver.
I am the future.
I am.
I am.
I am.
I am.
I am Ivy Tech Community College.
Classes start soon. Complete a free application today.
Rochester Telephone Company is hosting a photo contest for the cover of the new telephone directory. Get out your cameras, your smartphones, your Polaroids. It's time to take that winning picture. The theme for this year's cover is community. What image, what moment best captures the essence of Fulton County? Snap that photo and send it over to directory@rtc1.com. That's directory@rtc1.com.
Are you tired of your internet speed slowing you down? Not a problem. Get connected at the speed of light over RTC's advanced fiber optic network. Work, surf, or play on the net faster than ever before. Choose from multiple residential or business packages with speeds so fast it'll have you flying away. Already have RTC's Fiber Connect internet? Upgrade your package today. RTC. Local services, local support, and local investments.
Welcome back to Rochester Youth League Baseball on RTC TV. Abby Malco and Todd Beeler. We are at the top of the fifth inning. Tigers at the plate. If they don't score this inning to tie or take the lead, then it will be the Orioles game.
And normally we play six inning games in this league, but we have an abbreviated doubleheader tonight as part of a makeup, so we're playing 2 5 inning games. So just in case you think we're a little goofy there at home, that's the scenario tonight. So Tigers really in a good position here. They've got the top of the order up. They need just one run to keep this ball game going, and it's Kane Lutz taking on Trey Stasiak right now. Stasiak misses outside, so Kane way up in the count, 3-0.
And we've seen so many momentum changes with these two teams within the past two games, so this game is not even close to over.
That pitch right down the middle for a strike. And I'll tell you, Abby, we were talking at the break, the two ball games we've seen tonight, we have seen some very good baseball. We've seen some excellent defense. We've seen pitchers that have done a phenomenal job of peppering the strike zone all night.
Yep.
And it's just been a very good brand of baseball.
And too, as a pitcher and as the defense being the Orioles, you know, you walk your leadoff batter and you think, hey, that's the tying run on first base, and the go-ahead runs at the plate. So, you know, everyone counts here, especially Brock Beeler having drawn so many walks this game, as Trey Stasiak probably needs to be attacking.
That pitch misses up for ball one. So Lutz, the potential tying run at first. Brock Beeler at the plate represents the potential go-ahead or winning run. Well, I seriously doubt we're going to see this here, but this would be a perfect scenario to see a sacrifice bunt down.
I have this written down as a topic we should discuss. Being a softball girl, small ball is so heavy in the game of softball right now when you got your slappers and it's almost crucial to bunt. If you have a runner on first base, it's almost crucial to bunt them over. You know, traditionally you don't see this a lot in baseball, but earlier in the game we did have a Tiger bunt it down to first base. What's your take on bunts in baseball?
Well, this would be an excellent opportunity right now. You want to get that potential tying run in scoring position, especially with your 3 and 4 hitters coming up. Now, you really don't see that much in the rec league or youth league baseball here right now, as Brock draws yet another walk.
I think that's number five.
And does an excellent job because he gets that runner in scoring position. But for the Orioles' perspective, now they have the force play in place at third, at second. So they're going to be looking to try to get that lead runner down. But at the local youth league, they don't really work on the bunt too terribly often. If you would see that in an all-star tournament, or you would see that in a travel ball scenario or something like that, definitely at the high school level, you would see that strategy come into play far more often.
I agree. And earlier you said, you talked about now the Orioles have a force at third, and we talked about a couple innings ago, Yarber was on first base and moved to second base on a passed ball with two outs, and it eliminated the force at second base. And that's such a huge play, I think, when you have so many balls hit up the middle. The second baseman or shortstop can make a diving play up the middle and flip it to second base, and that's an easy third out and to get you out of the inning. But if you don't have the force out, then the hit up the middle could easily score a run from second base.
Absolutely. And that pitch misses up. So Andrew Dunwoody at the plate right now finds himself in a hitter's count, two balls and a strike. So be interesting. Any ball that hits the dirt or skips away from the catcher, we'll see how aggressive the runners on base are going to be. There's a nice pitch, painted the outside corner at the knees.
And now evens the count at 2-2.
Just a little bit of contact here, make something happen. There it is, right back up the middle. And Trey thought about going to first and then realized, hey, I've got an out at first. That ball was hit hard right back at him, so he had plenty of time to spin and get the lead runner. And that was a big play. And Coach Tony Stasiak now out to the mound for a conference with these infielders.
And such a difference, I think, too, from knowing college softball and watching and this being, young youth baseball. But on the softball field, you can lead off when the pitcher lets go. So if a pitcher gets a ball hit back to her and she tries to throw to first and she were to turn around to throw it at third base, she wouldn't have a prayer. So just difference in age and size and leadoff rules and things. But, I'm watching him go to first and turn around and go to third thinking, oh, he's never going to get him. But, just rules of baseball and them not being able to lead off in time allowed Trey to turn around and get the out at third.
Well, that's an excellent point. And, this is strict Little League rules. It's what you see on TV with the Little League World Series. Even at that level, you see that there's no leadoffs, and you're right. But it does an excellent job of teaching the basic fundamentals and skills of the game. Now, interesting strategy here. You've got Bryce Abbott at the plate with one out. Now, I would assume that Stasiak's going to attack Abbott. However, I don't think he's going to give in by throwing anything right down the plate. I think he's going to make him hit a pitcher's pitch, and we'll see how aggressive or how patient Bryce chooses to be.
I agree, and I think they had a conference just before Bryce gets up to bat. But, if I'm a pitching coach or a pitcher here, I say try and get strikes on the corners. But if he walks, he walks, because he's the number four hitter, and he can do a lot more damage if he gets a hold of it.
And there's a rope. Cannot be made, play cannot be made by the right fielder. There's Beeler rounding home, and they got him.
And hesitates at third base, whether it was the coach hesitating at third base or just not sure. But I don't know if the coach at third base slowed him down, but the throw was pretty high and the tag was very, very close.
Nice relay from right field to second base into the catcher. Miser had to come out in front of the plate a good distance to catch that ball, but had plenty of time to apply the tag for the out, and that right now tends to be the biggest play of the ball game.
I agree. and it's those big plays like that where, great slide, great relay, great tag. That's just a pure baseball play right there. Nobody did anything wrong. That's how the play went, and it could end up deciding the game.
Well, one key component there, your right fielder, Eli Stevens, charged that ball hard, couldn't get there to catch the ball in the air, but he did get his glove on it and knock it down.
Yes.
Otherwise, that ball goes to the fence, and there's two very easy runs across the plate.
I agree, and that's the thing. As an outfielder, you don't get a lot of action, but when you do, it seems to be very important action because you are the last line of defense. The next thing behind you is the fence, and that's usually not a good thing if it touches that.
And there's strike three called, and that is your ball game. Trey Stasiak comes in, pitches two solid innings to get the save, and the Orioles beat the Tigers 5-4 and complete the doubleheader sweep. Two very good ball games, two one-run ball games, good night for all these kids.
Yes, I agree. Some great baseball, like you said, a perfect night, and great for two good doubleheaders. Thank you for joining us here tonight, Todd, on RTC TV. Great conversation and great knowledge of baseball in both teams, so we appreciate having you.
Well, it was my pleasure, and maybe somewhere down the line we'll get a chance to do this again.
That would be fantastic. We hope to see you. And for everyone at home, you've been watching Rochester Youth League Baseball on RTC TV. We will see you next time.